गुरुरेव गतिः गुरुमेव भजे गुरुणैव सहास्मि नमो गुरवे न गुरोः परमं शिशुरस्मि गुरोर्मतिरस्ति गुरौ मम पाहि गुरो राम राम राम. So in the morning we had a discussion. We started with the fifth Sukti Ratnani, and as discussed, it is taken from Kalidasa's Kumarasambhavam. We discussed a little bit about Kumarasambhavam, how it is told to be the last work of Kalidasa, and we again discussed a very nice story called Asti Kaschid Vagvisheshah, the importance of this line, and then we came into Kumarasambhavam as it is. And I've told that it is a very simple plot. It is how Shiva and Parvati are brought to marry each other, and how their son Kartikeya is finally the person who ends the torments of Tarakasura. This is the storyline of Kumara Sambhava. As the name itself tells, Kumara is nothing but Kartikeya. Sambhava is occurrence or possibility. So the occurrence of Kartikeya, or nothing but the birth of Kartikeya, is the entire central point of this story. Again, it is a 17 sarga. So as I've told you, Mahakavyas are separated, are divided into sargas. And this particular work, Kumarasambhava, has 17 sargas. And again, critics who have, you know, gone through this literary work claim that only 7 to 8, the first 7 to 8 sargas of Kumarasambhavam are written by Kalidasa, whereas the remaining part is not written by, is not a work of Kalidasa, and it is some imitator poet who has completed the remaining sargas. And why this happened is not known, and it is commonly agreed matter that probably Kalidasa was not present to complete the entire Kumarasambhavam, and was only able to complete those first 7 to 8 sarkas. The plot is Tarakasura is a demon who has come to power, and he has gained a boon which gives him the power that he can only be killed by the son born to Shiva. And at this point of time, Shiva has lost Sati, who has entered into the fire at Daksha Yajna, and being totally disheartened, he has gone into deep meditation or penance, and he has become a Mahayogi and is not interested in any worldly affairs. And this is the reason why Tarakasura has chosen Shiva as the Shiva's son to be the person who will kill him. And the process of by which Shiva is made to marry Parvati, and finally the birth of Kartikeya, is the story. So we discuss the first sarga, briefly describing, again, the very first shloka is a very prominent shloka. It is starting from Asti, in the phrase Asti Kaschid Vagvishesha. The Kumarasambhava starts with the word Asti, and the important shloka is Asti Uttarasyam Dishidevatatma Himalayo Nama Nagadhirajah Purva Parotoya Nidhivagahya Stitav Prithivya Ivamana Dandaha. So this is the very first shloka. And the first sarga is dedicated to describing Himalaya, its its trees, its plants, its medicinal herbs, its animals, the tribes that are present, and the description of Himalaya is the main idea behind the sarga one. And as I've told you, there are several important shlokas which I discussed in the previous class about the first sarga, which again, as I've told you, the main reason why we should probably read any of these granthas is not because of the storyline, but what the kavi brings out in this storyline. So at every point of time, whenever Kalidasa gets a chance, he tries to give some sort of knowledge, some sort of education to the reader. As I've told you, there were so many small phrases, suktis, that you can come across in the very first sarga. For example, Eko hi dosho gunasannipate nimajjatindoho kirneshvivanka. So all these small points is made prominent by Kalidasa using his beautiful language, and he uses every opportunity to give such good advice. And then after this, we come to the marriage of Himalaya with Mena, and then the birth of their first son, that is Mainaka. Following this is the birth of Parvati, who is nothing but the reincarnation of Sati. And as previously told, Parvati is growing very quickly. She is growing similar to the faces of the moon. And it is told that she is progressing and growing every day. And she finally reaches adolescence. And once Narada passes by through Himalayas, and he comes to the court of Himavan, and he sees Parvati sitting next to him. Seeing Parvati, Narada comments that, yeah, she is worthy of marrying Lord Shiva. Having listened to this, Himavan is now determined to get her married to Shiva only, and he is not interested in any other offers. But Shiva is a Mahayogi at this point of time, and he is not coming forth with any offer from his side. So as was mentioned, Abhyarthana Bhanga Bhayena Sadhu Adhyarthamishte Avilambya Tirthe. So being, fearing the possibility of a rejection of the offer, Himalaya did not approach Shiva himself. So though Shiva did not approach, even Himalaya did not approach Shiva asking him to marry his daughter because he was afraid that Shiva might tell no to the offer. So with this, because of this fear, he did not directly go. What he did was he went to Kailasa, and there he salutes Shiva and tells that, please allow my daughter Parvati and her friends to come and help you with your daily work. So they can help you with, fetching water or any such small things, they can help you. So please let them stay at Kailasa and help you. Again, Vikara Heto Sati Vikriyante Yesham Na Chetamsita Eva Dhira. So Shiva is a person who is Sita Prajna. He is a total controller of senses. But in order to prove that he's actually controlled, he has complete self-control, he felt that only in the situation where you have distractions and you're still able to control your senses is when your true self-control is brought out. Hence, great people are not distracted by any distractions and are able to retain their self-control. To prove this point, it is as though Shiva accepted Parvati to stay at Kailasa. So that ended Sarga 1. Now, Sarga 2. So what happens is now, this is the side story. So this is actually, there are multiple storylines in each sarga that you can see. But so the first sarga has now ended with Parvati reaching Kailasa and serving Shiva. Now the second sarga starts with a different storyline. So at this point of time, Tarakasura has become very strong and he is starting to spread his atrocities all around the three worlds, and he's starting to torment the people. And even the devatas are unable to tolerate his strength and have been defeated. So what happens is Indra and the other devatas, they come to the creator, Lord Brahma, who is now meditating. They come to Brahma, and since he is meditating and he has closed his eyes, in order to wake him up from this meditation and so that they can tell about their problems, they start praising Brahma. And the thing is, I won't go into the details because you have one lesson that I have not covered, which is Brahmastavaha, and this exact situation of Kumara Sambhava, Indra and the other gods praising Brahma, is this main aspect of Brahmastavaha. Since we have that separate lesson, I won't be going into the details at this point of time. So when we discuss Brahmastavaha, we can come back to this. So Brahmastavaha is nothing but the part of Sarga 2 of Kumara Sambhava, where Indra and the other gods praise Brahma so that he can come out of his meditating state and listen to what they have to say. That is Brahmastavaha. So now, after Brahmastavaha, after they have praised Brahma, Brahma comes out of his state of meditation and he asks. Once he is opened and he sees all the gods and he welcomes them very well. So he is very happy that the gods have come here. But Brahma observes something different. He tells, why is it that the gods who are always glowing with luster, glowing with aura, why are they not shining as though they have been covered by mist? So Kaliyasa mentions it beautifully, telling that the glow of gods have been reduced as though the glow of some beautiful object has been covered by hima, that is snow or fog. So why is it that your luster, why is it that your glow has been reduced, is what he's asking. Now, he individually points out to the gods and asks them some questions, which are very interesting, and we have to praise Kalidasa for it. So he asks Indra, oh Indra, why is it that the Vajrayuda that you are having is no more glowing and appears to become blunt? He asks Varuna, oh Varuna. So Varuna is usually, this also describes the Ayudha that each of these gods wield. So Indra holds a Vajrayuda and Brahma asks, why is it that your Vajrayuda is not glowing and it appears to have become blunt? Then he asks Varuna. So Varuna holds a whip, something like a whip that you use to ride a horse, a similar type of whip, like a pasha is what he holds. And he asks, why is it that your pasha is no longer as powerful as it was, as though it is like a snake which has been made, which has been given some medicine so that it has fallen asleep. So why isn't it in that strength that it was previously? Then he asks Kubera. Kubera is told to be holding a gada. So he's asking, oh Kubera, where did your gada go? It's as though the branches of a tree have been broken away and thrown. So he does not have the mace anymore. And Brahma identifies it and tells it, you appear like a tree whose branches have been broken away. Then he asks Yama. So Yama, why are you not as glowing as you were before? And why do you appear to be a very insignificant god? Is what he asks. Adityas, who are known to spread light, he's asking, why is it that you have lost your glow? Maruts, the gods of the wind, he's asking, why is it that you have stopped? Rudras, who are the incarnations of Lord Shiva, he's asking, why is it that your heads have been, why are your heads down in defeat? So then he asks, all the gods together, what has happened that has caused so many changes? Has some bigger enemy dethroned you from your positions? He asks further that, see, my job was to create the world and I had appointed you gods to protect it. So why is it that you're here and that too with such a bad state? So this is how beautifully Kalidasa describes how Brahma identifies that something is wrong. Of course, we know that Brahma should be knowing everything, but he wants to get the answer from these devatas. And this is how he identifies each of these gods and beautifully tells that something is wrong. At this point of time, Sahasraksha. So Indra is called Sahasraksha. That is, he has 1,000 eyes. So now this Sahasraksha looks at Brihaspati. That is the god, that is the guru of all the gods, Deva Guru. He looks at Brihaspati, indicating that, please, you go ahead and tell Brahma. So Indra does not want to tell it himself. He asks Brihaspati to tell. So now Brihaspati comes forward and he tells, oh Brahma, see, there is nothing that you don't know. You surely know that we have all reached this particular state. Indra's Vajrayuda is no longer strong. Varuna's Pasha is no longer effective. Yama is no longer as glowing as he was. So all this is because we have been defeated by a demon called Tarakasura. Now, Brahma has identified some aspects. Now, Brihaspati is giving a very beautiful, very beautiful phrases telling what is the effect of Tarakasura on each of these gods. He's telling, so Tarakasura, after gaining so much of power, what he has done, he's telling. So sun. So what is the greatness of sun? He's able to spread light everywhere. He is like the person who can give us heat as well as light. But after Tarakasura has come to power, what he has done is, he has made sure that the sun, Surya, can only emit so much of light that the lotuses in Tarakasura's ponds only should glow. So there should be no other glow that sun can have. So his glow has been limited by Tarakasura because of his strength. Now the moon. We know that moon is, goes through Shukla Paksha, Krishna Paksha, it waxes and wanes. But now Tarakasura, what he has done is, he has made sure that none of the other worlds experience Chandra. Chandra is always at Tarakasura's palace only, except for the crescent moon that is on Shiva. None of the other faces, Shodashakala, we have 16 faces of the moon. So moon is told to be absent for the entire world, except for Tarakasura. Now wind, Vayu, he is known to flow everywhere. He cannot hold air, but still Tarakasura, because of his power, what he has done is, he has ordered wind to the Vayu not to flow faster than a hand fan. So how fast a hand fan blows air, that is how fast the wind should blow. And Vayu is so scared of flowing fast that if by chance, while flowing a little fast, if a flower in Tarakasura's garden breaks and falls, then he's scared that Tarakasura may punish him for trying to steal the flower. So that is how weak Vayu has been made by Tarakasura. Oceans. So now Samudra Raja is called Ratnakara because he's the source of gems. But what has happened is, even Samudra Deva, what he is doing is, he is waiting eagerly so that whenever a new gem is created by the ocean. So we know oysters create pearls and you have different types of gems in the oceans. So this Samudra Raja, he has been forced in such a way that whenever a new gem is created by Samudra, he immediately takes it and goes and gives it to Tarakasura. Further, seasons, Rutus, they have all stopped changing. Wherever Tarakasura's palace is there, Vasanta Rutu is always exists. So Vasanta Rutu is one of the most beautiful seasons that we have. And Tarakasura has made sure that none of the other worlds experience a season change. And Vasanta Ritu always exists in his palace. Serpents, that is, these different types of serpents that are present, poisonous serpents, they are also no longer as strong as they were. And, you know, these serpents have a mani, naga mani on their head, which glow. So Tarakasura is using these ferocious serpents as his night lamps. So the glowing naga mani is being used as night lamps by Tarakasura. Now, Indra. Now, this Indra is a very clever guy. So what he thinks is, let me try to gain the favor of Tarakasura. So what he does is, Kalpavriksha is the tree that is present in Devaloka, and it is only to be used by the gods. But he also, being scared that he should not be punished by Tarakasura for anything, he makes big bouquets of Kalpavriksha flowers and he sends it to Tarakasura. So he's making sure that he can give gifts to Tarakasura and escape the punishment. So even Indra is trying to find such means. So having told all this, Brihaspati tells, So, O Brahma, so this is the situation of all the gods. Tarakasura has been doing, he has been controlling all the gods. He has been tormenting all the three worlds. And this is the current state of the world. Further, what he is doing is, he is trying to destroy Nandanavanas. He's trying to, dispurify or, corrupt, the water of Ganga. So he's trying to make all this bad deeds in the world, and has even stolen Uchchaishravas, the horse of the Devatas, that is in Devaloka. He has even taken away that. So all the efforts that the gods have put in to defeat Tarakasura have now been totally destroyed. So we have no other hope, and all our efforts have gone in vain. Further, before approaching Brahma, so they would have gone to Vishnu, because Vishnu is usually the person whom the gods approach if they have any problems. So when Vishnu was asked for help, he also tried to help. So what did he do? He sent his Sudarshana Chakra to kill Tarakasura. But instead of killing Tarakasura, the Sudarshana Chakra became the pendant in the Tarakasura's chain. So even Sudarshana Chakra was also ineffective against Tarakasura. Hence, what he asks, Brihaspati tells, what I ask from you, O Brahma, is we want someone who can defeat Tarakasura and bring back peace to the world. So now, having spoken for such a long time, Brihaspati ends his speech and Brahma starts to speak. And beautifully, Kalidasa explains that the situation, the transition from Brihaspati talking to Brahma talking is beautifully explained, telling that the words of Brihaspati is like the thunder of the clouds just before rain. And Brahma's words are like the rain that pacify the earth. So Brihaspati has been speaking and his, words have been compared to the rumbling of the clouds or the thunder of the clouds. And what followed next, that is the polite and the melodious words of Brahma, is compared to the vrishti, that is the rain that follows these thunders. After this happens, Brahma starts speaking. And finally, after he tells, yes, I realize that Tarakasura is tormenting the world. But he tells, what you desire, that there should be someone who can end Tarakasura and bring dharma and peace back, that will happen. But it won't happen immediately. So it will happen in some time, but surely not immediately. Further, see, if they have come to Brahma, what is their main intention? So Brahma will be able to use some power to, create someone who can kill Tarakasura. That's what is the thought that Devatas would have come with. So they would have thought, okay, now that Vishnu could not defeat, so let us come to Brahma. He can probably create someone who can kill Tarakasura. But Brahma, even before they have such a thought, he tells, but I will not create the destroyer of Taraka myself. Why does he tell this? Beautiful, Kalidasa has used beautiful words to tell that Vishavrikshopi Samvardhya Swayam Chetum Asampratam. So what he's telling is, see, I was the person who gave Tarakasura the boon. Hence, I myself cannot be the person who should kill him. For example, I have planted a poisonous tree. Maybe I knew it, maybe I did not know it. But once I have planted the tree, I myself cannot uproot it, is the beautiful example that Kalidasa uses to tell that since Brahma is the person who gave Tarakasura the boon, he cannot create or he cannot give another boon to someone else to kill the same Tarakasura. Hence, he'll tell that it is not possible from me. So don't expect me to create someone who can help you with this. Finally, he also tells, see, it was not that I wanted to give him this boon, but his penance was so strong that I had to give him the boon, or else there would be no prominence to the word called tapas. To full know, to give the right fruits for his tapas, I had no other option but to give him this boon. And he also tells, okay, now that I have told you what was the cause, like that I gave this boon and why I gave the boon, I have told you. Now I will tell you the source, I'll tell you the solution also for this. So since Brahma has already told the cause, he also wants to tell the solution. What he tells is, a warrior son will be born to Shiva, and it is his power that will help them kill Tarakasura. Also, he adds, Parvati should marry Shiva for Kartikeya, that is the son of Shiva, to be born, who can kill Tarakasura. Hence, gods, see, you have tried your best, you didn't succeed, you were defeated. Vishnu tried, he could not do anything. Since I am the giver, I cannot do anything. So the only thing that you can do is try to bring Parvati to Shiva and make sure that they marry so that Kartikeya is born and Tarakasura is ended. So he is telling Devadas that you don't have anything else to do. You cannot do anything else. So the only way is try to get Shiva to marry Parvati. So after having told all this, he tells the son born to Shiva and Parvati, you should make him the commander. He should be the Senadhipati, and under his guidance, the army of the gods will be able to triumph over the Tarakasura and become victorious. So after having gone heard to this, now Indra is at least satisfied. At least they know that some solution is possible and what has to be done. So the solution given by Brahma is, you should make sure that Parvati and Shiva marry. So now he after having understood, he thinks of a very sly plan. He thinks of a very tricky plan, and he thinks of Manmatha. So he thinks that the Manmatha is the right person for the job, and he thinks of Manmatha. So this entire Brahmastavaha and the speech or the solution given by or the suggestion given by Brahma to the Devatas is the matter of Sarga number 2. So Sarga number 2 ends with Brahma giving the suggestion of what has to be done, and Indra thinking of Manmatha to be the right person for the job. So this ends Sarga number 2. Sarga number 3. So now the third Sarga begins like this. So now Indra has thought about Manmatha. So he feels that Manmatha is right for the job, and it is customary. So if someone superior to you thinks about you, the person whom you are thinking about will get some message. So of course, we don't know how that works, but still that happens. And the person whom you are thinking about appears before you. This happens in several mythological stories. So whenever Lord Shiva thinks about, let us say, some Rishi, that Rishi appears before him. So that happens. So similarly, once Indra thinks about Manmatha, Manmatha comes and appears in front of Indra. Now, there is a very beautiful, incident that happens here. So, who have come to Indra's, Brahma's Brahma Loka? Gods, Brihaspati, and Indra, the gods, and Lord Brihaspati. So these people have come to Brahma Loka. But now, they have, spoken with Brahma, and they have come out of Brahma Loka. And having come, all these gods and Brihaspati, they are together. But once Manmatha is thought of by Indra, Manmatha comes there. Once Manmatha comes, Indra, he forgets about all the other Devatas and Brihaspati, and he sits on his chariot and goes alone with Manmatha. So he does not tell the other Devatas to accompany him. He does not call them. He does not even think about them. All he thinks about is, okay, Manmatha has come. Okay, he just goes along with him. And Kalidasa beautifully tells what is the reason what is the context behind this. He tells, Prayojana pekshitaya prabhuna prayaschalam gauravam ashriteshu. So what he's telling is, probably, so prayojitana prayojana pekshitaya, in order to get some benefit, what do they do? Prabhunam ashriteshu. So the masters, they show interest in their servants only if they have some work to be done. So surely they want to see. Indra is the master of all the lords. He is the lord of the gods. Hence, Kalidasa is beautifully telling that only when a master wants some job to be done by the servant, he will show a lot of love towards the servant. So let us say a master calls his servant and he starts speaking very friendlily. He asks him, okay, are you living well? Are you able to get food and all? So the servant should not think that he has gained some good status. It's only because the master wants some work to be done. So he's trying to pamper the servant to get the job done. Similarly, even this Indra, just because he has some work to be done by Manmatha, he tries to give more prominence to Manmatha and tries to forget the other Devatas, and he goes to Indra Loka. what further he does is, once he reaches Indraloka, he sits on his throne and gives the throne right next to him for Manmatha to sit. So probably that was the place where Brihaspati sat or some other gods sat. But in this context, because he wants some work to be done, he brings and puts Manmatha in the seat, in the throne, just next to him. And he further, he, you know, pats his back and, you know, asks, how are you doing and all that. So he starts asking Kushalopari. Now, just by seeing, so Indra is known for his trickery and his, you know, skillful acts. But Manmatha, what happens is, he's very pleased. So after a very long, probably never, or this is the first time, but Manmatha feels very grateful that, you know, Indra is calling him. He's, you know, accompanying him to Indraloka. He's giving him such, you know, good respect and all this. So he's very grateful and he tells, oh Indra, I'm very grateful and I, you know, acknowledge your favor. So tell me, what is, you know, the problem? And he gives a, you know, series of things. So thank you, but no, I've been, you know, thank you for your, you know, favor, and I'm ready to help you in any aspect. So he'll start telling what all he's capable of doing. He, you know, tells these things. He asks, oh Indra, is there some person who is doing a lot of penance in order to get your Indra, you know, get your throne? So is someone trying to do penance in order to get your throne? Tell me. Or is there someone who is trying to attain moksha by doing some penance? Or is there some woman that you desire who is not ready to accept you? What be the situation? Tell me. I will make sure that your wishes are fulfilled. But Indra is still quiet. After this point of time, he tells a series of things. So he'll tell, so is there some king who is not ready to give sacrifices to you? So he'll tell a series of things that, I know his probably understanding that, do you want me to do this? Do you want me to do this? But Indra is silent. Finally, Manmatha, in that, you know, pride, in her, you know, keeping his pride up, he again makes one more statement telling that, do you want me to even make Shiva destroy his self-control? Of course, that is what Indra wanted. So when Manmatha makes this statement, do you want me to make Shiva lose his self-control? Then Indra tells. Then Indra starts speaking. Because till that time, whatever Manmatha told, he didn't want that. But now that Manmatha has spoken, he has hit the nail on the head. Now Indra tells, oh Manmatha, see, you are capable of doing all these things. And further, listen, oh my friend, he'll start addressing Manmatha as his friend and tell that, oh friend, listen. See, I have only two weapons with me. One is my Vajrayudha and one is you. But the problem with Vajrayudha is I can't use it everywhere. Let us say a person is doing tapas, a very noble tapas. If I try to use Vajrayudha, it is ineffective. But you, my friend, you are that weapon who will work everywhere. So you are my most strongest weapon and you work everywhere, whether my Vajrayudha works or not. So he starting to pamper starting to praise Manmatha. Further, he tells, see, one must be given work based on his strengths. So if a person is capable of doing some work, only then he should be given that work. Similar to how, because Adishesha was strong, that is why Vishnu asked him to hold the earth. Because he was capable, he wouldn't have told someone else to hold the world, hold the three worlds on his head. Similarly, I know that you're capable of doing this. Hence, I feel that this work is fit for you. And as you have currently identified, yes, I want you to break Shiva's self-control. And this is not, and again, as we know Indra, he makes another statement. See, this is not for my own swartha. I don't want anything out of this. It is for protecting the devatas and the world that I'm asking you to do this. So Manmatha, of course, he is very easily fooled. So probably he took, you know, Indra's words to be serious. So then what exactly has to be done? Now Indra starts telling. He tells, see, Shiva has to be attracted towards Parvati because Shiva and Parvati has to be married. But Parvati is ready. So Parvati, since Narada had made the statement that she will marry Shiva, she is ready to marry Shiva. But there is no, you know, acceptance from Shiva's side. So all your job is to make Shiva accept this offer so that they both marry. And see, he again makes a further statement telling that he is also very great. So he's telling that, see, somehow this task has to occur because Brahma has told this will occur. So whether, so I know it happens today or if it happens after 10 years, it will happen. But I want you to be the person who can do this so that you can get fame from this. So this is how he's trying to inspire and trying to, you know, force Manmatha to become you know, excited to take this job. Finally, Manmatha, you know, after, you know, getting so much of praises from Indra, getting so much of honor from Indra, he tells, okay, my friend, see, you have asked me to do something. Surely I will do it. Don't worry. Now, he, after telling this, he goes, he starts, you know, he thinks of a plan and he starts going towards Himalaya. And always you should know that Manmatha is always accompanied by his wife, Rati. So Rati is the wife of Manmatha and they both go together. And one more thing is, Manmatha has a very close friend, which is Vasanta. So Vasanta is nothing but spring season. So spring season is the friend of Vasanta, you know, Manmatha, because it's only by means of Vasanta season that Manmatha is able to succeed. Hence, they both are considered to be very close friends. And Kalidasa also uses that in his work. So Manmatha, his wife Rati, and his best friend Vasanta, they three people go to Himalayas, that is Kailasa Parvata, where Shiva is residing. Now, Shiva, now he has to, you know, plan accordingly to get to be successful in his mission. So what happens is, Vasanta takes different forms so that the mood is set for Manmatha to use his Pushpabana. So for Manmatha to be successful, Vasanta should be the influencer. So Vasanta, if it influences Shiva, then that is the first step towards success. So what happens is, now Vasanta takes a beautiful form in the Himalayas, and the flowers that have never bloomed on Himalayas also start blooming. They start spreading the fragrance. Bees start humming. Of course, we know Himalaya is a very cold place, but still, because of the influence of Vasanta, even that place becomes a place where different types of flowers have started to bloom, and, you know, the trees have started growing their new leaves. You know, bees have started humming, birds have started, you know, singing, fawns, deers and fawns have started roaming around, cuckoo birds have started singing. So all these things that you find in Vasanta Ritu, spring season, Vasanta creates this in Himalaya. The effect of this is, all the animals are now influenced by this Vasanta Ritu. In Kailasa, to be frank, it is a place where people come to detach themselves from distractions of the world to do penance. Even the animals are told to be detached from these worldly matters, and they are told to also lead ascetic life or sadhu life. But because of this Vasanta's influence, even these animals and birds also have started enjoying this Vasanta Ritu. And even the sages who have been, you know, living in that area doing penance, even they have started getting distracted. Animals and birds have started to, you know, experience the feeling of love, and they started to, you know, love each other. So this is the situation that Vasanta has created. But all this has happened. The things that previously have never happened have occurred, and, you know, animals have changed their attitude, birds have changed their attitude, but still Shiva is still in samadhi, he's still engrossed in meditation, and he is totally not affected by Vasanta. Hence, Kalidasa, again, at every point I'm telling you these shlokas, because Kalidasa has used every such situation to give beautiful phrases. He tells, only the person who can control his senses is undisturbed by any obstacles. Atmeshwaranam nahi jatu vighnaha samadhi bheda prabhavo bhavanti. So Atmeshwaranam, people who have total self-control, Atma is soul or any senses, Atmeshwara is sthita prajna, one who has total control of his senses. Nahi jatu vighnaha samadhi bheda prabhavo bhavanti. Even obstacles cannot break his samadhi. Samadhi is meditation or trance or penance. So for a person who has total self-control, no such obstacles can distract him from being self-controlled. Beautiful statement by Kalidasa. Now, as this is happening, what happens is, now Ganas. So of course, Ganas are not as, you know, meditative and as self-controlled as Shiva. So they, you know, once they see the Vasanta Ritu's influence, they also start dancing and singing and all this. But of course, Nandi, being the, you know, follower of Shiva, is also unaffected. And what happens is, Nandi starts seeing this Ganas dancing and making a lot of noise, but Shiva is meditating. So Nandi comes out and he puts his finger on his lips and tells, keep quiet. And Kalidasa beautifully explains that just by this sign made by Nandi, what happened is, the entire Himalaya that was now enjoying in Vasantotsava stood still. Gana stopped dancing, cuckoos stopped singing, they stopped even moving. Even the birds and the flowers and even the wind, you know, the flowers also stopped moving, because it's as though the wind had stopped blowing at all. And Kalidasa beautifully explains that it was as though the, you know, lively forest that had come to, you know, the forest that had come to life because of Vasantotsava had suddenly formed a picture. Because in a picture, once you paint, if you draw a bird, it will be there. If you draw a flower, it will be there. It won't shake. Similarly, because of just one signal of Nandi, everything stopped. And it became like a picture of the forest rather than the forest itself. Beautiful description of the, you know, by Kalidasa. It goes to show that Nandi's words or Nandi's orders were, you know, followed by each and every person, not just Ganas, even the trees, even the flowers, even the animals also were respectable towards Nandi's orders. And once he made that action, everyone stopped. Now, after, you know, when this is happening, Manmatha secretly goes away from the, you know, he does not come into the vision of Nandi, and he secretly goes to the place where Shiva is meditating. So again, Manmatha, when he sees Shiva, Kalidasa beautifully explains. So Shiva is sitting in penance. How is he sitting in penance is how it is described. We know that from Bhagavad Gita that when you're doing meditation, your eyes should be focused at the tip of your nose. Similarly, even Shiva's eyes are now focused on the tip of the nose. He's sitting in a way that it is like still water. Water that is totally still. And it is like a flame that has no wind around it. So a flame usually flickers because of the wind. But he's like that flame. Shiva is like that flame that has not seen wind at all. And he's sitting so still that even you can't see the slight movements when you inhale and exhale. So when you inhale and exhale, your body moves. But Shiva is meditating in that state wherein you can't even identify if he's breathing or not. Now, Manmatha's idea was to make Shiva attracted towards Parvati. While every other person in Himalaya was influenced by Vasanta, Shiva was not even influenced, let alone influenced. He was sitting in a state where even Manmatha felt that the work he had come for, surely he can't attain. So when he spoke with Indra, he was confident. Yeah, don't worry. I will, you know, break the self-control of Shiva, he had boldly told. But now, seeing Shiva in this particular state, in this particular self-control, total self-control state, Manmatha feels that, okay, I think I won't be able to succeed in Indra's mission. And he is so, you know, afraid, like he's so perplexed by the situation that he does not even realize that his bow and arrow have fallen or have slipped from his hands. So he's so, you know, concentrating on Shiva and seeing his form that even he does not realize when his bow and arrow fell from his hands. At this point of time, Manmatha is totally doubting his own skills. Manmatha feels that, okay, I can't do this. And, you know, whatever I do, this Shiva will not be influenced. And so he has decided that his job will remain unsuccessful. But at that exact point, what happens is the Parvati enters. Parvati is now still a princess. So she is still wearing those, you know, royal ornaments, royal garments. She is decorated in the royal way. And she comes and seeing her. So she, you know, she's a young lady. She's very beautiful. She's very, you know, she's like beauty reincarnated in itself. So seeing her, so she comes and, you know, she starts doing the work. So seeing the way that, you know, how beautiful Parvati is, Manmatha gets one ray of hope. So he feels, okay, I understand that Shiva is no longer a person that I can try to approach. But at least seeing Parvati, his confidence is regained at least a little. Now he feels, okay, now we have seen that Parvati is such a beautiful lady, I think I can somehow manage to, you know, break Shiva's self-control and make sure that they marry. So this is the turning point where Manmatha feels that after seeing Parvati, that he can somehow make sure that his task can somehow be successful. No, but he has to wait for the right opportunity. So he's standing next to a tree and observing what is happening. Parvati comes and she salutes Shiva. And of course, the thing is, if you read any of these stories, you'll always read that whatever Parvati is doing, Shiva is totally in meditation and he does not open his eyes, he does not speak anything. But when you read Kalidasa's Kumara Sambhavam, Shiva is not like that. He speaks. Of course, he's still in meditation, but it's not like he won't move. He won't, open his mouth. He won't open his eyes, anything. Here, Shiva is, for example, in this case, when Parvati comes and salutes, Shiva blesses. So it's not like Shiva does not move at all. And the blessing that he gives is also the choice of words that Kalidasa has used is also beautiful. He tells, Ananyabhajam patimapnuhi. Ananyabhajam is, pati is husband. Ananyabhajam pati is a husband who does not serve any other woman. So that is, he'll be loyal only to you. Such a husband, avapnuhi, you get. So you get a husband who will only be your husband. He will not have any other wife. So such a blessing he'll give. But see, we should know that, again, Kalidasa beautifully in the very next line after telling this, he tells that the words or the blessings given by great people will always be fruitful. Nahi Ishwara Vyahritayaha Kadachit Pushnati Loke Viparitamartham. That is Ishwaranam, that is the great people, Ahritayaha, the blessings of these great people in this world, they will never be false. But if they are given a blessing, it will surely work. So what it means is, see, Shiva is himself giving blessings to Parvati that he will get a very good husband. And we know that Parvati's intention is to marry Shiva himself. So it means that Shiva's blessings should not go in vain. And why this won't go in vain is because Parvati is nothing but Shiva, you know, Sati is reincarnation. So it is not like Shiva will not marry Sati. He will marry Sati, but in a different form. Hence, even though Shiva does not intentionally give this blessing, his blessings will come true. That is what Kalidasa mentions beautifully, that Nahi Ishwara Vyahritayaha Kadachit Pushnati Loke Viparitamartham. The blessings given by great people shall never go in vain, and they will always be fruitful. That is true even in this blessing given by Shiva. Now, after this has occurred, now Parvati starts. So after the daily ritual that she does is, so she gets some water, she washes Shiva's feet, she, you know, gets some flowers, she puts it on his feet, and finally she puts a mala, she puts a garland around Shiva and does the daily puja. So as this is happening, so she has come, she has saluted, she has started worshipping, she has washed his feet, and now she goes to put the garland. At this point of time, the thing is, Shiva is now looking at Parvati. So when she is putting the garland, of course, since they both are now close to each other, Shiva now is looking into Parvati's eyes. Manmatha now feels that, yes, this is the right time. Because now Shiva is not totally meditating. He is looking at Parvati. So he's not totally closed his eyes into meditation. Since this is the best chance he'll get. So maybe this is the only chance that he will get when Shiva has opened his eyes and he's seeing Parvati. Hence, he feels that, yes, this is probably the right time when, you know, I should use for my mission. So what he does is, he decides that this is the right time, and he uses Pushpa Bana. So he's the bow that he uses called Pushpa Chapa. It is a bow made by flowers, and the Bana he uses, the arrow, is also called Pushpa Bana. But of course, it is told that Manmatha has 6 different types of Banas, and for this particular situation, he feels that he should use the Bana called Sammohana. So having decided to use Sammohana Pushpa Bana, he decides to use it, and he puts the arrow on the bow string, and he pulls it and starts aiming. Now, the greatness of Manmatha that is described by Kalidasa here is, see, Manmatha has not yet released the Sammohana Astra, but still, just by putting the Sammohana Astra on the bowstring itself, just by putting it, Shiva loses his Samadhi state momentarily. So Shiva, just by this incident of Manmatha putting the Sammohana Astra on his Pushpa Chapa, Shiva loses his self-control. So that itself signifies that if Manmatha can do such great things, he is truly a powerful person, powerful god. So he loses his, you know, self-control or Samadhi state momentarily and starts looking at Parvati, and he gets attracted. But he being Lord Shiva, the Trinetra, he immediately, without any delay, he again regains his self-control. He loses it for a moment, that's all. And again, immediately he regains his self-control, and now he angrily, so again, here, even Parvati has been influenced by Sammohana, but she has not yet come out of the Sammohana's effect. But Shiva, being the person who is known for his penance, Tapo Yogi, he has come out of that Sammohana's influence, he has gained his self-control, and now, with angry eyes, he's looking everywhere for the source of this small distraction that he had. As he's looking around, he now looks at Manmatha. He's still, you know, aiming his bow. In just that point of time, all this has happened. So he sees Manmatha, who is already aiming his arrow, and he's ready to release his arrow. And even before he could release, Shiva opens his third eye, and a ball of fire comes out of it. And what happens is now the gods are all observing. So it's not like the gods are somewhere and they've sent Manmatha. They've sent Manmatha and they're also observing from, you know, some other place what is happening. Once Shiva sees Manmatha and his third eye opens, they all come running. Krodham Prabho Samhara Samhara. Oh Lord, controller, calm down. Control your anger. Even before, Yavat Giraha Ke Marutam Charanti. Even before these words came out of these gods' mouth, that, oh Lord, control your anger. Even before these words came out, Tavat Saha Vahnihi Bhavanetra Janma Bhasmavashesham Madanam Chakara. Even before those words could be told by the gods, the fire that emanated from Shiva's third eye turned Manmatha into ashes. Again, in a different shloka, which, you know, worships, which, you know, describes Manmatha, like how you have shlokas for individual gods, there's another shloka for Manmatha, which again has uses this exact, you know, situation and tells it, Karpura iva dagdhopi, someone who is burnt like camphor, Karpura, if you just touch the fire, it starts igniting. Similarly, even this Manmatha was instantly burnt like camphor. So that is again another shloka which tells the beauty of how Shiva instantaneously burnt Manmatha.
So Shiva killed him, no?
Sorry?
So Shiva killed Manmatha.
Yeah. So Shiva has killed Manmatha. Yes. So Shiva has opened his third eye. Okay. And from that, the fire that came burnt Manmatha to ashes. Now, Shiva, now, after this, so now that Manmatha has gone away, all his Vasanta's influence and the influence of Sammohana have all gone away. So now Parvati is also back to her conscious mind. Till this point of time, even Parvati does not know what has happened. So once Basano, the Manmatha has been burned, even Parvati regains her consciousness. Actually, in that point of time, Parvati feels that, okay, now Shiva has started liking me and probably I can get him as his husband. So that thought process is still going on in Parvati's mind when all this happens within an instant. Now, Shiva has done this and now he has come out of a samadhi stage. So now he does not want to interact with Parvati or any of them. So there are a lot of women. So Parvati has come with her sakhis. So there are so many women. So it is told that once a person comes out of samadhi state, he requires some time, even a god like Shiva requires some time to again regain samadhi. And in that point of time, there could be a chance when Shiva could again lose his self-control. So all this happened just because of aiming the Sammohana. So probably if Manmatha had released his Sammohana, probably the situation could have been different. But that did not happen. So once Shiva had come out of his samadhi, he saw that he's surrounded by women like Parvati and her sakis. So he felt that, okay, this is not the right place to be. So he immediately vanishes. So now Parvati is left alone with her sakis. And also, see, two things. Parvati, for an instant, thought that Shiva liked her. But in the very next instant, she realized that he burnt Manmatha with the fire of his third eye. Secondly, she has come with her sakis, her servants. In front of them, Shiva, rather than accepting her because of Manmatha's influence, he indirectly, so she felt, this is her personal opinion, she felt that Shiva disgraced her by, you know, killing Manmatha and leaving the place. So Parvati is totally disheartened and she feels totally, you know, like she feels very sad that she was, you know, ashamed. She was made to feel shame in front of her servants. So having felt ashamed and dejected, she was very sad and she came back. She started coming back to her father's palace, that is Himalaya. So this is the end of third sarga. So third sarga's name is usually called Manmatha Dahanam or Kama Dahanam. So that is the burning of Manmatha. Now, the fourth sarga is called Rati Vilapa. So now we know that Rati had come with Manmatha. And actually, if you read Kalidasa's Raghu Kumara Sambhavam, it is initially told that when these three people come, Vasanta, Manmatha and Rati, when these three people come, Rati is actually quite doubtful. She feels that, okay, this might not be a right thing to do what Manmatha is asked to do. But still, it is told that a good wife will always follow her husband in whatever he does. So she keeps quiet. So during this incident, when it is happening, Vasanta is busy influencing the environment. Manmatha is busy aiming his arrow. Rati is a little away. So she's not exactly where Vasanta and Manmatha are. So she is standing a little away, awaiting Manmatha to return. She is still not aware that Manmatha has died. So the fourth act is called Rati Vilapa. That is the agony or the sorrow of Rati. Now, Rati, because of, okay, once the Shiva's anger takes its form, the surrounding people are all left unconscious. So Rati has fallen unconscious because of this incident, and she has not even realized what has happened to Manmatha. So after some time, she regains her consciousness and she feels, oh, probably this is the effect of my husband's arrow that I fell unconscious. So probably he's successful, and she's eagerly awaiting Manmatha's return. But when she goes in search of her husband, she finds is a heap of ash, and she understands what has happened. She understands what has happened. Now, this is when she starts, because of course it is told that there are two ideal couples in Hindu mythology. One is Shiva and Parvati, and one is Rati and Manmatha. So these Rati and Manmatha are considered to be those divine couple who are known for their bond. So they don't live away from each other, is what it is told. So now that Manmatha has died, Rati is expressing her grief in the most severe extent possible. So she tells that, of course, it's a very lengthy description, but I'll tell some important aspects that are told. So she tells that, oh Manmatha, you always told that I resided in your heart. But today I realize that you are lying, because if I were in your heart and you were burnt, then even I should have been burnt. So all you were telling these many years that I was living in your heart is false. Also, she tells that, see, I thought that I was the, Pativrata who loved my husband a lot. But even after my husband has died, I have not seen myself being killed. So that she's saying that I am not dead. My husband is dead and still I'm living. Hence, she tells a very beautiful, Kalidasa gives this beautiful statement, Kathinaha khalu striyaha. Hard-hearted are women. The intention being told is, see, Kalidasa wants to tell that women are capable of controlling emotions and hardships. We know that throughout the life, women are able to withhold and, control their emotions and hardships and, torments more than men. But in this case, Rati is using it to tell, see, that was a good thing that women have. But in this particular context, she feels that, okay, that should not have been the case, that women should not be this hard-hearted. So the Kalidasa is trying to give out the good virtues and qualities of a woman. But in this case, Rati is using it, telling that, okay, this should not have been the case. Women should not be hard-hearted, because if I was not hard-hearted, I would have instantly died when my husband died. So Kalidasa is stressing on the point that women have a lot of self-control and they are able to withhold a lot of pain and hardships. Beautiful sentence given by Kalidasa. Next, after this is done, again, she searches. So again, the continuation, the story continues. The sarga continues with Rati telling in different ways that I should have died with you. Why did you go alone? So all that happens. But finally, after the end of all this, she tells. She searches. So she has no one. So everyone that she came only with two people. One is her husband Manmatha, and one is Manmatha's friend Vasanta. So she does not have anyone to talk to. Husband is gone and she has no one else to talk to. So she searches everywhere and finally she comes across Vasanta. So Vasanta has come. Of course, she also has realized what has happened. So once Vasanta comes, Rati's grief increases even more. Because, Kalidasa puts it in beautiful words, Swajanasya hi dukkha magrato vivrita dvaram ivopa jayate. That is, when you see your closed ones, your sorrow increases and it breaks all bounds. Let us say you are crying for something and your mother comes and tells, oh, what happened? Then you start crying even more, because when you see your closed ones, you try to let out all your sorrow. That is what Kalidasa is beautifully telling. Svajanasya hi dukkham. So if you have some dukkha, that is grief, Svajanasi agrataha, in front of your svajanas, in front of your relatives, or be it your friends, dvaram ivopajayate. So it will break all the doors. So it will break all bounds and it will flow seamlessly. That is why once seeing Vasanta, so Vasanta is the very close friend of Manmatha, and seeing someone close to Manmatha and someone close to her, she was, she let out all her grief and started weeping or grieving even more. Then she also tells, oh Smara, oh, so Manmatha is called Kamadeva, she is called Smara, so all these names are there. So she uses them interchangeably. So she tells, oh Smara, okay, if not, maybe you don't like me. So probably you liked some other woman. You didn't like me. But at least your friend is here. He is also in grief. He is also looking for you. When he is sad, why don't you come and show yourself? Again, Kalidasa beautifully tells, Daitaha tu avasthitanam drananam nakalu premachalam surajane. That is, the love that you have for your wife may be false or may be temporary, but the love that you have for a friend is always chiram. It is always everlasting. It will never perish. So even though you may not have liked me, at least because of the friendship that you have with Vasanta, please come back. Please show yourself. So this is how, again, she's trying to, you know, let out her grief. Finally, she tells, okay, I don't feel like living anymore. So, oh Vasanta, please make some arrangements so that I can, you know, sacrifice myself and go along with my husband. So that is how, you know, she asks Vasanta for help, telling that, and again, beautifully told, Shashina saha yati kaumudi. When the moon goes, even the moonlight goes along with it. Meghena saha tadit praliyate. Megha, when the clouds go, the thundering clouds go, even lightning, tadit is lightning. So even lightning goes away with them. So when such inanimate objects, go along with their concert. So here it is, she's trying to describe that Shashi, the moon and the moonlight are a couple. Clouds and the lightning are a couple. So when such inanimate couples follow each other, when one goes, the other one also goes. Me, being a living creature and who is known to love my husband so much, how is it that I am not able to go with my husband? So please, Vasanta, make sure that I reach my husband. So make arrangements so that I can sacrifice myself. And she, after having told all this, she finally decides, okay, if Vasanta helps me or not, I don't know. I will sacrifice myself. I will die and I will go along with my husband. So she decides that, and she decides to, you know, give up her life when an Akashavani comes. So an Akashavani speaks and it tells, oh Rati, do not, you know, do what you are about to do. So do not kill yourself. And it also tells, your separation from your husband will not be for long. So you won't be separated from your husband for a very long time. So don't end your life now. And what happened? So why, the reason why this happened, the Akashavani will also tell. So what had happened is, Brahma created the Manasaputri Saraswati. So when he created Saraswati, what this Manmatha would have done is, he would have used his arrow to make Brahma attracted to his own daughter, Saraswati. And because of that, Brahma would have cursed him that when you try to make such bad deeds, you will also be killed and you will also be separated from your wife. So that curse would have been given by Brahma. And the result of that is now Kama, that is the Kamadeva, has been Kamadahana, the burning of Manmatha has occurred. And Akashavani also tells, when Shiva and Parvati marry, that is without your husband's influence, even without Manmatha's influence, when Shiva and Parvati mutually agree to marry each other, that is when you will reunite with your husband Smara, your husband Manmatha. So thus, Brati, of course, she's very sad, but Vasanta consoles her, and you know, in this way, she, you know, has to bear with the separation from her husband Manmatha. And this is how this sarga number 4, that is the fourth sarga, ends with Rati Vilapa, the grief or the agony of Rati. So with this, we'll conclude today's class. Of course, I'm taking a lot of time for Kumara Sambhava because being one of the foremost granthas of Sanskrit, I want you to gain as much from this as possible. I'm trying to include as many shlokas as possible because probably at this point of time, you may not understand it. You may not feel the importance of it. But probably once you finish your higher level of Sanskrit, probably somewhere around Turiya, Pravesha, you come back and probably revisit these lessons. Probably you'll be able to relate and you'll be able to understand and appreciate Kalidasa more. Because personally, this was, of course, I have never done this before. I've told you before also. So this is the first time that I'm explaining Sukta Ratnani in so much of detail. And personally, I feel that, you know, having gone through these granthas myself, I feel more appreciation towards these kavis, Kalidasa, Bhasa, whoever be it. I feel the appreciation because writing such a great work from such a simple storyline is a great feat, and I want you also to realize that. So probably for now, I would probably think that you should probably understand the story and you know, go ahead with the meaning. But later on, come back, give this lesson another watch. You'll be able to understand, and probably you can go through the Moola Grantha. If you want, I can provide it to you if needed. So I can give you, and you can probably reread it. And then I'm sure that you will be able to appreciate this particular literature even more. So with that, we'll conclude today's class. So of course, as I've told you, I'll be only discussing till Sarga number 7, because that is the only part which Kalidasa has written. And also the second reason being, I have not found any manuscript that is giving the description and the explanations for all the 17 cantos. If I find, I'll just make a swift run through from Sarga number 8 till 17, because Sarga number 7, so 5, 6, 7, so these three sargas will take it up in the next class. So I want to discuss these 7 in more importance, because it is Kalidasa's original work. After this, whatever comes, probably I'll just tell you the storyline, not going into the depths of these individual shlokas, because for the completion of the lesson or the completion of the story. So with that, we'll conclude today's class. If you have any doubts, you can ask, or else we can end today's meeting. Guru reva gatihi guru meva bhaje guru naiva sahasmi namo gurave na guru paramam shishurasmi guru matirasti gurau mama pahi guru. Ram Ram Ram.